Warning: the following episode contains subject matter and scenes that some viewers may find upsetting, disturbing, or unnerving. Please note, viewer discretion is advised at all times. Sit back and enjoy.
Aggressive, sadistic psychopath. A man who fails to resist his impulses, does not learn by his mistakes, but above all is cold and callous.
The ball-peen hammer, similar to this one, has been used in the initial attack in most of the killings.
Sutcliffe's victims ranged in age from 16 to 46.
He can behave in between the crimes perfectly normally.
I'll kill her for not ringing. So they said you won't have to do, somebody's done it for you.
And a gruesome game of hide-and-seek with the police that lasted for six long and terrifying years.
I have the greatest respect for you, George. But Lord, you are no nearer catching me now than 4 years ago when I started.
Hello and welcome back to I Could Murder a Podcast and welcome to Series 2. I'm joined, of course I am, it's Ben.
Hello my friend, we meet again. It's been a while, where shall we begin? Creed.
Don't start with Creed.
Oh, okay.
Awful band, really bad band.
No.
Ben, are you excited to be here?
Unbelievably excited, sir.
Yeah, what have you been up to?
Well, what haven't we been up to?
No, what have you been up to?
Well, went through a watering my plants too much phase.
Yeah, I saw some pictures and they were very much drowned.
Didn't take any photos.
Well, okay, I was there. So people with a keen eye might realise we're no longer in Butts Cottage.
Thank goodness.
We're in Boston Sound.
Thank goodness.
We said we'd be back with a bang and we're here now in Boston Sound with producer Dan. Say hi, Dan.
Hello.
So that's not the voice of God. Dan will be interjecting every once in a while.
Interesting note, though. This case will have several voices of God. Not just Dan, but it'll be a repeated theme.
Yes, very good.
Case.
Very
so, good. I'll get that in nice and early, Dan.
We're very happy to be back. We're very excited for Series 2. We've got a lot of big cases we're going to be getting into. But before we start,
a quick word from our sponsor, if you can believe that much.
We want to take a moment to thank our brand new sponsor, Surfshark.
Little old us with a sponsor, hey? Surfshark is a VPN app and browser extension that gives you access to an unbelievable amount of things.
Now, when me and Ben do research for these episodes, we sometimes encounter websites we can't access because of our location. But Surfshark is here to save the day.
So with Surfshark, you can change your virtual location with just a couple of clicks, allowing you to unblock content.
Now, this isn't all. Picture the scene. You've gone on holiday. You go onto Netflix. Suddenly, there's a million true crime documentaries you've never seen before. You haven't even left your hotel room by the end of the holiday. Well, now Surfshark has you covered. You now have access to 15 different Netflix libraries, all from the comfort of your own home.
It also hides your IP address and encrypts your online information in order to safeguard your privacy.
Now Surfshark are sorting you, our lovely audience, out.
If you head over to surfshark.deals/murder using the code murder, you will unlock 83% discount plus an additional 3 months completely free.
They also have a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there literally is zero risk.
So why not hit the link in the description below and start surfing the shark?
It's January 2nd, 1981. The South Yorkshire city of Sheffield slowly comes to a close. Children are put to bed. Workers are clocking out. Friends, loved ones, and even perfect strangers are toasting to the bright hopes of a new year and all the potential it has to offer. As last orders are called, they spill out onto the streets from within the crowded pubs and clubs and stumble off home without a care in the world. This is Sheffield. This is South Yorkshire. They don't carry the worries of their neighbouring regions. They don't carry the fear of the dreaded Yorkshire Ripper as they wander off into the misty night. Sergeant Robert Ring is on a routine patrol with a colleague. He sees a woman in a car with a man and immediately suspects a sex worker and client encounter. The sex worker tells Sergeant Ring that the man in her car is her boyfriend and that there is nothing to worry about. Ring thinks he remembers her for previous prostitution offences. The man in the car says his name is Peter Williams. He adds that he's desperate for the toilet. Ring allows him to go behind a nearby storage tank. The police meanwhile find the car's license plates are false, and Peter admits that so is the name he is given. He says his real name is Peter Sutcliffe, and he's immediately detained and kept in the cell overnight. Police notice Sutcliffe's physical similarity to the Ripper profile. His blood tests show he's blood group B, one of the few indisputable forensic details and relatively rare blood groups in the general population. Later that night, Sergeant Ring returns to the scene of the arrest, where he finds that the individual didn't empty his bladder behind the storage tank, but had instead emptied his pockets of a knife and ball peen hammer.
So yes, we are covering the Yorkshire Ripper, the first case of series two.
And a big case at that, Mr. Peter William Sutcliffe.
Yes, indeed.
It's been one that has come up in many requests we've seen in the comments section. So to those people, thank you very much. And here you go. But it's also been one that personally, I think both of us have wanted to kind of do a bit of a deep dive into for quite some time. Me being from the South, living in Yorkshire, there's kind of first-hand experience. Not first-hand experience.
I
live there, but it's a very big case in those parts of the world. It affected the whole country. Big case, arguably the biggest one we've covered so far. So
it is the biggest manhunt in the UK, so it's a very big case indeed. Before we get into it, we like to often do a kind of looky-likey, all that kind of thing with it. I was thinking he looks a bit like Captain Hook's snidey disco brother, and I think his hair looks like black candy floss.
Okay, you're talking about like peak 80s Peter Sutcliffe, yeah?
Yeah,
peak. Okay, peak.
Prime Sutcliffe.
Yeah, Sutcliffe in his prime, yeah. I can see that, I've also got kind of a transitional one, so peak Sutcliffe, peak Pete. George Michael?
No, George's hair was never like that.
But the beard and the face was...
Well, you got the beard. Okay, so usually with cases like this, we always like to look back on the childhood and see, you know, how they grew up and the kind of family background and see if there was anything, any red flags or telltale signs to what these people would become.
Yeah, and there was a kind of, not immediate warning signs, but he was born into an interesting family dynamic. So firstly, he was a couple of weeks premature brought into the world. So he was a very small baby and would grow up to be a fairly small child as well. So that was a running theme. He remained small. But
did he grow bigger when he grew up?
As he was growing up, he did grow up.
How
yes.
does age work?
2nd of June, 1946, Sutcliffe was born in Bingley, which is in Yorkshire, West Yorkshire specifically. He is first child to be born to Kathleen and John, although he would eventually be joined by another 5 siblings. So I think straight away, before we get into Peter, a little bit more detail and his upbringing, it's an interesting point to talk about the father, John, my first kind of insight to him was actually a video after his son was, you know, convicted and caught. But he strikes you as kind of a traditional kind of big and bold Yorkshire man. Apparently he was very, very much an outgoing guy. He was an extrovert. He was an extrovert, so loved being down the pub, loved being with people. And I think he was expecting a similar sort of interest to be born into Peter, but it wasn't quite to plan.
Yeah, and his dad, he was a bit of a jealous type, mm-hmm. his mum, but he a bit of a hypocrite as well, wasn't he? He would be very controlling of the mum, mm-hmm. But also wouldn't mind playing away himself.
Well, that's it. And he was also at times alleged to have been physically aggressive with the children and with the wife. So it's an interesting household, 5 kids and a semi-alcoholic, sport-loving, aggressive, cheating father. So, Peter, then, in terms of a role model, he's not got, he's not brought into the, the strongest male role model, but very close with his mum.
Yeah, so he would lambast in front of the whole family, his mum, and say to the whole family that she's been cheating and kind of really portray her in a bad way. But Peter was very close to his mum. I think his dad being quite, as you say, quite aggressive at times, he was quite a shy kid as well, and he would often hide behind his mum. And yeah, spent a lot of time with her.
Yeah, there was an interesting kind of event that happened quite early on in Peter's life, where his dad had, suspected that Kathleen had been, playing away, and actually took Peter with him to confront her while she was with another man. Now, we've read different stories about whether or not this guy was an ice cream man or a police officer.
Yeah, a policeman. It's very different jobs.
Interesting YMCA that would be.
It would be Mr. Whippy or PC
Whippy.
PC Whippy. It could be. Could have done both.
She, well, according to John, she probably did do both. Hey-o! And we're back.
Just carry on murdering.
In his early years at school, he was said to have been a loner, really reclusive, didn't like to play with other children or socialise at all, to the point where actually John, I assume on his lunch break, would head to the school and berate Peter from outside the playground to go and play with other kids. So, you know, go on, come on. Come f***ing play with the other kids. I couldn't even do an accent, but...
Yeah, I think there's an interview with them, which we'll play a bit now.
He rather shunned the company of other boys because they were always seemed to be much too big for him. You could walk past the school yard during the play period, in the afternoon, and he'd be stood in a corner by himself.
He wasn't the one leading the gang, and he'd participate in pranks and things like that, but it would always be quite harmless. He was kind of forgettable as a kid.
Very forgettable. Very forgettable. And I think with him being John and Kathleen's firstborn, you know, there were all these expectations that he was going to be just like his old man,
yeah.
And, you know, the popular guy down the pub. But yeah, no, it didn't quite work out that way. But a very unremarkable childhood. So he ends up... hating school, actually. He found it really hard to focus on his schoolwork. You know, he was unexceptional in terms of his education, didn't have a big group of friends, and he wanted out of school as soon as possible.
Yeah, so he actually left school at 15 and he got a job. Where else would suit him better but then working as a grave digger? Which is
the graveyard shift.
Yeah, which isn't really, yeah. No, no, anyone, it's not really the first thing. I'll leave school and I'm going to go be a grave digger. Not belittling grave diggers,
no.
But it's very, very fitting into what actually it plays out in Peter's life.
Yeah, absolutely. And he's this is his first kind of encounter of actually a real friendship group. So it's an interesting set of characters that work down at the graveyard.
When he's working at the grave digging site, he got a nickname from the other workers there, which was Jesus. Because he had a nice little neat beard, is what they said, which was an odd nickname for Peter Sutcliffe.
Yeah, well, as well as that, he'd got into bodybuilding. So he'd been, you know, a lot of the bullying throughout his school years was around his size. You know, little Petey Sutcliffe on the playground, puny legged Pete.
Imagine you're a horrible kid.
No,
these are coming off the top of your head like nothing.
No. I googled them. I didn't make them up.
You googled puny little Sutcliffe.
Puny legged Pete, sorry.
Oh, sorry. That's all right. That's all right. Then.
Small little Sutcliffe was the other one. Again, I guess to kind of fight back at the bullying that he'd suffered, obviously gets fascinated and really throws himself into bodybuilding. So starts to get a bit of a figure. He actually ends up being able to beat both his brother and his father at arm wrestling.
Well, there you
go. So for a 15-year-old, you know, it's not bad going.
Yeah,
I imagine.
Well, with that strength that he gained, obviously he was a grave digger. He would often kind of dig up old graves, and he as I said earlier on, mate, he is a prankster, but he often would do pranks that were very harmless. But he once chased some schoolgirls with a skull, which was funny. He tried to convince some of his friends to come and look at some of the dead females in the mortuary. Mm-hmm. He said, "I have the keys. We can go and look at two right ones," is what he said. Which is horrific. And he also apparently hit an old gravedigger in the head with a shovel for a joke. Because that's funny.
So I already imagine the his other fellow co-working gravediggers are quite a bunch of characters, and they must have some, you know, fairly decent sense of humor as well. That I read they were, you know, prone to playing pranks on each other, but even for their standards, Peter took it to a new level.
Yeah.
Which was interesting to read, but yeah, chasing a girl down the street with a skull.
Yes, and he'd also often steal jewellery. He wants, you know, he would give them away as presents, kind of the rings he would steal from the graves as well. So yeah, not the nicest lad. So he's obviously already at this point got a weird fascination with death, and he has no problem being around dead bodies. Another weird fact that I picked up on him, this is a bit random, he suffered from hay fever pretty badly, and once he was in bed for 4 days. So I don't know how, but I've got hay fever, but never bad enough to keep me bedridden.
No, and if anything, I get hay fever pretty bad. You've heard me sneezing, Dan, haven't you?
Yes.
Having moved from the south to Yorkshire, I suffer far less from hay fever in Yorkshire than I do down south. So some geographical hay fever.
That's something for the tourist board of Yorkshire.
Yeah, take note, please. Yeah. So on the voice of God, then, I think that takes us nicely on to kind of another event that took place whilst Peter was a gravedigger. And that is that while in a freshly dug grave, he began to hear voices. This is where it gets really interesting. He's stumbling around. He actually climbs out of the grave to find where this voice is coming from. His recollection, he states that it sounded like multiple voices talking over each other. So I imagine like a really bad podcast. Why didn't you find that funny?
Oh, sorry.
This is apparently, he would later recollect that this is, according to Sutcliffe, the voice of God, and he found it on a Polish headstone. Interesting. And then the voices that he was hearing.
How do you mean, sorry, he found it on the gravestone?
The voices were coming from a Polish headstone.
That's bizarre.
Mm, interesting, yeah. But fluent English voice.
Hmm, well, there you go.
And
bilingual gravestone.
Yeah. This is one of the many different justifications or motivations behind what he would later go on to do. But apparently this voice would tell Peter that he needed to clean the streets and rid them of all the sex workers.
I've heard it's been labelled his divine mission. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which is hyping himself up quite a lot. Shall we get into the timeline, Ben? Because there's a lot to cover.
So as we mentioned, it's a big, big case to start off. And with that comes a big, big timeline. For me, this case can be put down to Ben's magic three M's. Manhunt. Mistakes. There were many, many mistakes in this case. And that is partly what allowed Sutcliffe to continue doing what he was doing for so many years. And the final M is mayhem.
Manhunt, mistakes,
and mayhem.
And mayhem.
Yeah, the three M's.
I say one M, murder.
You know, we both play different systems.
There you go. Ben's magic.
Things that make you go.
No, not things. He killed people.
Yep. So we already talked about, obviously, his childhood, his upbringing, leaving school, his early and interesting jobs. We're going to go from 1969, the year of 1969. Sutcliffe is first arrested. Sutcliffe first comes to the attention of the police when he is arrested in an area known to be frequented by sex workers. He is discovered holding a hammer and charged with going equipped for stealing. An interesting charge there. Hindsight, of course, will prove that this was a disastrous misreading of the situation.
Yeah, well, I guess it's like if you get a bag full of, if he's got a previous in terms of, you know, any kind of physical crimes.
I'm assuming the girl that was chased down the street with a skull didn't raise that as a concern to the police.
No, they probably just thought it was a funny joke.
Dicking around.
It's just Peter. Stop digging up the graves, you daft bugger. Probably something like that. But yeah, I mean, you were not going to immediately assume he was planning to kill, because you just think, yeah, it probably made sense. They look, okay, he's got things ready to go in and commit a crime of stealing. So I think it'd be a bit harsh to say to the police there going, you've made a mistake already. In September 1969, Sutcliffe's first known attack happens in Bradford in the Red Light District after a series of encounters with sex workers. He felt disgusted with himself and he actually attacked a sex worker with a stone in a sock.
The rock and sock connection.
I felt like you had that prepared.
And what a connection it was.
Yeah, I mean, it's odd. I've heard of like a snooker ball in a sock, and that's...
Yeah, that's very mafia, I feel.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
There was a lot of kind of negative stigma associated with sex workers at the time. So they weren't given maybe as much support from law enforcement as anyone else would have done. And I remember actually that Sutcliffe was pinned for that slightly. So he admitted it to the police. The lady filed a complaint that he'd struck her. But when the police went to his door, he said, "I didn't hit her with a rock in a sock. I just slapped her to the back of the head." And he got away with it because she was a sex worker. And they said, "Right, that's fine. Just don't you do it again."
Yeah,
and that was that. So they kind of had a dim view on the victims in this case, of course, until it was widened to possibly be, you know, any female at risk. I mean, we're not really touched on, obviously, Sutcliffe and his interest in females. So no girlfriends through school, no girlfriends through his teenage years. The only girl he really encountered was a girl that he chased down the street with a skull. So, not very experienced with females at this point.
The time I knew Peter for that roughly two-year period, he never had a... girlfriend.
He never had a girlfriend?
No. A good-looking lad, there was no doubt about it, you know, in his own way, but his conversation wasn't really too good, you know, not much chat.
He used to ask me to, if I'd a mate that had make up a foursome, but none of my mates were ever interested, you know.
develops an interest quite early on, possibly from inherited from his father, I'm not sure, but a keen interest in voyeurism, as well as kind of watching women go about their business in the various red light districts within West Yorkshire. So his first thought is to attack someone with a rock in a sock. On the 10th of August 1974, Sutcliffe marries Sonia Schirmer. Now, he had actually met her a few years prior in 1966. At the time, Sutcliffe was 20 and still a virgin. During that time, she suffered several miscarriages, and they were informed that as a result, she would not be able to have children.
It's a bit of background on her. She was very different to Sutcliffe growing up. She grew up in a very kind of conservative household. They listened to classical music. They didn't have a TV. The parents were very kind of wanting them to do better, so they learned classical instruments, whereas Sutcliffe's childhood was very different to that. And I know her father wasn't overly impressed when she brought Peter home.
Yeah, the bodybuilding gravedigger with a quirky sense of humour.
The gravedigger's a quite a good wrestling name, though. And you'd be a bodybuilder if you're a wrestler anyway. So in a way, it all works perfectly.
Another interesting thing to mention, you mentioned the parents weren't quite so keen on Sutcliffe, and this could be as a result that they were forced when they married to live with them, and this was put down to the fact that Peter was in and out of different employment, but also that he didn't have enough money for them to afford their own place, and this is in part because he was spending a lot of his money down the red light district.
On the 5th of July 1975, Sutcliffe would go on to commit his second assault, and this attack was on Anna Rogolsky. Apologies if I've pronounced that terribly.
Sounded good.
She was walking alone and he struck her unconscious with a bullpen hammer and slashing her stomach with a knife. He was disturbed by a neighbour whilst he was doing this, so he left her without killing her. She would go on to survive this after extensive medical attention, but was psychologically traumatised by the attack, which of course...
This is the thing. And I mean, his victim count is high enough as well, both for, people that he murdered, but people he attacked, and that would go on to survive. But if you think of the ongoing impact from that, or the psychological impact of that afterwards.
Well, like you said, you mentioned earlier before we started the fact that you speak to people now, obviously being a southerner up in the Leeds kind of
area. I work that into the conversation early with strangers as well sometimes, which I've learned.
It's a weird thing to do.
Yeah, but I'm so fascinated by this case that I introduce myself, we have a chat, the weather, not great in Yorkshire ever, to be honest.
And you're tell me about the Ripper.
Talk to me about the Ripper, yeah. And it's kind of a 50-50 divide if they decide to continue the conversation with me, but some people obviously are in the camp that it's a horrible stain on the region's history, and the less spoke about him the better. I did some irreparable
so they're like, shut up.
Yeah, well, it could be more of a slight on me. Yeah, but then there's the second camp that, as soon as I mention it, are extremely excited to talk about it, and not proud of the fact that it's happened, but they'll either know someone that was directly impacted by this, or the friend of a friend. It's they're all areas as well, eerily, that I know quite well. So there's the Roundhay Park, which we'll go on to some more detail on, but I walk my dogs there, so it's quite eerie, and that fascination has always been there. It wasn't the reason I did move to Yorkshire, just to...
I don't think anyone was thinking that.
Thank god.
But you did live at home for a little while beforehand. So I would say to say the echoes of his terror still rings true around the Yorkshire area.
Absolutely. So the very next month, Sutcliffe would follow a very, very similar pattern to the attack on Anna, this time attacking a lady called Olive Smelt. Follow the exact same instance in that he would strike her from behind with a ball peen hammer. And this time, instead of slashing her in the stomach area, I assume this is because she fell forwards after the strike, he started to slash just above her buttocks, so kind of the lower back. Again, Sutcliffe was interrupted, and again he had to flee. Just like Rogolsky, Olive survived, but was impacted massively, psychologically, and would go on to never really trust men after this.
Yeah, it's completely understandable. I think as well, obviously getting a big blow to the head, can also leave some damage there as well. So yeah, suffering with clinical depression afterwards, I guess, yeah, not trusting men after that, you cannot blame her. It would be a very traumatic experience. So in the same month, Sutcliffe attacked a 14-year-old girl, Tracy Brown, and he struck her from behind, hit her in the head with a hammer 5 times, which is horrible.
And she survived this.
Yeah, she did survive this. So there's an interview with her, and obviously she was very traumatized by this. She spoke to the police afterwards, and the description she gave of Sutcliffe was the image that they got from
her. Yeah, I remember. Yeah.
Is great. It's like
spot on.
Yeah, she did such a good job, especially because, I mean, you imagine being hit in the back of the head.
This guy had been bodybuilding. The fact that she survived, was it five hammer blows?
Yes. And she was 14 years old as well. So yeah, the fact that she's managed to survive that after bodybuilding.
And recount his you know, the image of him so accurately.
And she even said about, you know, his accent, which we'll come on to later, mm-hmm. but she gave a really good account from it. And as I said, like being hit from behind, she still managed to capture all this information for the police. So yeah, all in all, that was a very, you know, you wish that the police took heed from that to the evidence, and you know.
But. Now, during this time as well, Sutcliffe had obtained and started using a HGV license as well. So left the grave digging role, and he
Spence,
was...
Spence, some people might not know what that is. Do you want to explain to them what a HGV license, what it means?
I actually don't know. What does
Heavy goods vehicle.
Heavy goods vehicle. Fabulous, fabulous. Am I right in thinking there are certain levels that you can achieve within HGV? I know that's... not an interesting question to ask, but I'm pretty sure you can do, like, you can qualify to...
Join us next week when we talk about the history of tractors.
The Model D, a name that was soon to be the talk of the country.
The 30th of October, 1975, the Ripper, as he would go on to be known, claims his first victim, Wilma McCann, who was a mother of four at the time. Sutcliffe followed a similar pattern that he had been in following her in the dark while she was on her own. He struck her twice in the head with a hammer before stabbing her 15 times in the neck, chest and abdomen.
So I read that apparently there was going to be an encounter between them of a sexual nature, and he was unable to perform and she mocked him for it. Mm-hmm. Apparently he got so angry that he went to his work bag, got a hammer out, and then he took it.
Yeah, so again, this is, I mean, we read the written and verbal accounts of Sutcliffe's eventual statement, and this is a very poignant moment going back on it. He claims that she belittled him because he didn't really know how the transaction itself worked and how the act would then carry out. She was very unfriendly and kind of belittled him as well, so he really did not handle that rejection or kind of the way that they communicated very well at all. And that would be something that kind of kick-started.
Yeah, and also, like, the kind of heartbreaking thing was she did have a young family, and the next morning they went looking for her. Luckily, they didn't find her themselves, but yeah, it's very sad. The only bit of evidence the police really got from that situation was they got a workman's boot print, mm-hmm. which was size 7. So he was, you know, I think he had some issues with terms of obviously growing up, quite small and tiny, tiny feet. Dan, how big are your feet?
8.5.
8.5. Oh, well, you had to put the half in there. I feel like you're slightly self-conscious about it as well.
It makes a difference, so half.
Like, that's fine. All right, back to it.
So of her four children, sadly, one of the children would go on to take their own life.
She reached the age that her mother was when she was killed, and mm-hmm. she felt like she didn't deserve to live longer than her mother, and she committed suicide.
That's so sad.
It's so sad.
Another one of her children is now a motivational speaker, and he in one of the documentaries we watched in preparation for this, he gives a very heartbreaking account of the police coming home and saying, your mummy has gone to heaven and you won't be seeing her again. But he's now, you know, gone on to be, he does motivational speeches all across the country. But he mentioned that the reference point photo that the various news outlets were using he was really upset that it was a bad photo of his mum. And he actually referred to it as looking similar to Myra Hindley.
Oh, okay.
And it is. It's not, he said his mum was a beautiful woman and a beautiful person. And he felt that together with the fact that she was, you know, announced in the news as a sex worker, twinned with that photo, it was really not a good look for, you know, it wasn't a very sympathetic
kind of
publication. So, yeah.
So Sutcliffe will go on to commit his next murder in Leeds in January 1976, where he stabbed 42-year-old Emily Jackson 52 times.
52 times.
That's like, when you hear the kind of cases where it's like that, you know, you just imagine they're not absolutely, they see red in a complete fit of rage, and it's
mayhem. One of the three M's.
Or murder, as...
The 1M system.
Yeah, the 1M system.
52 times. So to go back to, the 4 or 5 hits to the head with a hammer.
Yeah, it's horrible. I mean, it's a similar kind of situation. She was a sex worker. Sutcliffe had a very clear idea of the kind of people he wanted to go after. So not only did he hit her in the head with a hammer, he also dragged her into a rubbish-strewn yard with a sharpened screwdriver to stab her in the neck, chest and abdomen. And Sutcliffe stamped on her thigh, leaving her behind an impression of his boot.
That size 7 boot.
Yep.
There you go.
Yeah, it just seems like he had a lot of anger.
Yeah.
Anger within him.
Aggressive, vicious. Okay, so the 9th of May, 1976, Sutcliffe is again on the prowl and he's driving around the streets of Roundhay. Lovely area, by the way.
Why are you trying to sell leads on Yorkshire? Right,
sorry about that. So, 9th of May, 1976, Sutcliffe is again on the prowl for his next victim and he picks up 20-year-old Marcella Claxton in Roundhay Park in Leeds. Marcella was walking home from a party. She'd had a fair bit of alcohol so far that night and happily gets into the car with Sutcliffe. Now, an interesting detail here is that whilst he's driving her home, in inverted commas, she asks if he can pull over so that she can go to the toilet. And as she gets out of the car, you know, he obliges, lets her out of the car. As she gets down to go to the toilet, she's then getting back, ready to get back up, and she feels a blow to the back of the head. So Sutcliffe speeds off, not knowing that Marcella is still alive. And at the time, she was actually 4 months pregnant. She would later go on to have a miscarriage, unfortunately. But she did inform the police and make the complaint. She provided a very accurate description of Sutcliffe, but perhaps due to the fact that she was a minority at the time, the police didn't take her account seriously.
I mean, as you, the mock-up as well that she said was very on point, and you think there's now two people that have said, hammer, this mock-up, there's a clear link here between the cases, and even the people that were, you know, the actual people that did lose their lives, there's a clear link in terms of the kind of wounds that they suffered. Mm-hmm. So you think the police are now starting to get an idea. This isn't just a random one-off.
Yeah.
This is someone going out there attacking people. On the 5th of February, 1977, Sutcliffe would go on to attack Irene Richardson, a Chapel Town sex worker. He would take her to a park and bludgeon her to death with a hammer. Once she was dead, this is a really odd one because I think he's starting to get a bit of a buzz from the kind of crime reports because he actually positions the body after he's killed her and it's speculated he actually moved it around 2 or 3 times. So when the person walks around the corner, when they discover the site, because it's quite a clear way you walk around apparently, that they would see it in a certain way. So he moved the legs, he put the boots in certain places. He was thinking of it kind of like a director. This is how I want to relate the scene to everybody. It's a really odd, and start thinking into his psyche. He's getting the buzz from this. He wants to be known for it in a certain way.
Yeah.
It's very bizarre. Like, yeah, even moving her possessions to look a certain way.
Yeah, it's really interesting because if you really take a bird's eye view on this timeline and mistakes is kind of on both parts. He doesn't come across as your highly intellectual serial killer. No. He would go on to make quite a few mistakes, but for then him to have this elaborate kind of right, well, I want to set her up like this and do this and this. It's really interesting because at some points he just seems like quite a lazy guy as well. In some of the things he does. But he's obviously gone the extra mile here to position her and then obviously cause a bit of an impact on whoever discovers her body's life.
Yeah. He left tire tracks there in the murder scene. That's the only thing that the police could take from that case. But again, I think they're obviously going to think bludgeon in the head, sex worker, they're linking it all together.
Yeah, same area, round here again. Yeah. Yeah. So on the 6th of February 1977, the tracking inquiry is launched. Now, having acquired a good quality capture of the tire track by the latest scene, police were able to extract that and began a colossal task of trying to identify the make and model used by her killer. By careful measurement of the track width and turning circle of the car, police were able to narrow the potential types of vehicle down to just 51 models of car.
Yeah.
I say just 51 models of car. I mean, I couldn't name 20 models of car.
No, I mean, yeah, it's obviously, the police don't have a lot to go on. I mean, they have two good mock-ups to go on, but they're going off this, and it's like, yeah, they found those models. 53,000 car owners of those models.
A small-featured car driver.
Yeah.
It's essentially what they're looking for.
Exactly. And so they contacted over 30,000 of those owners and had no results. But I just think, like, obviously, if you're that policeman calling people constantly about it, by the time you're on your
6001, you're not going to have the same gusto.
No.
I mean, the thing is, the police get ripped to shreds about this whole case. It went on so long. They did make a lot of mistakes. They definitely did. They didn't help themselves a lot along the way. But at the same time, as you do start to say, they're definitely putting in
the work. The man hours were there. The graft was there.
It's hard work. It's not working smart. But they're putting in the hours, but in the wrong places, it seems.
100%. And that'll be a recurring theme.
2 months later, on the 23rd of April, Sutcliffe killed Patricia Atkinson. She was a sex worker from Bradford in her flat. So that's quite a different thing for his other cases. He killed inside a household, which he's starting to change his mode of killing. And it's quite risky because obviously getting seen going in there. All these other places are very kind of hidden away.
He's kind of left the safety of his vehicle as well.
Yeah. I had this horrific term which kind of stuck with me after this. Obviously, after he would begin bludgeoning, he would, just go to absolute town, and it was horrible. But apparently the term they use is bag of marbles skull, which is the official term, because it's fractured all over the skull. So it's literally like a bag of marbles, which is horrible. And I'm amazed that that's actually a term that is used. But yeah, that was a term that was used for that murder, bag of marbles skull.
And he actually left a bloody boot print on one of the bed sheets, is that right? Is he doing this on purpose with the boot? Because this is two now where he's left a boot indentment on a body.
I think he's just lazy. He's not thinking.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't know, there might be something else in it, but it just seems to be a mistake rather than a thought out calling card. It's a terrible calling card. Mm-hmm. A boot.
Yeah. Boot. Yeah, it's like the wet bandits.
Yeah.
Leaving the taps running. That's a good calling card, actually.
It could actually ruin the crime scene. Exactly. So, wet bandits, fair play.
There you go. Okay, so the 26th of June, 1977, 2 months later, he murdered 16-year-old Jane McDonald. Now, this is a big one because Jane was obviously 16 at the time. This happened in Chapeltown, by the way, but she was not a sex worker. Sutcliffe would later go on to explain that he was under the impression, a complete impression, that she was a sex worker. She wasn't. And the public perception then changed massively and showed that all women were potential victims and not just sex workers.
That's the horrible thing, isn't it? Everyone thought, this is fine. If it's, they're sex workers, it doesn't matter. And then seeing someone who isn't a sex worker, let's take this more seriously. And it's just a sign of the times. It's horrible that it took someone who wasn't in that industry to be taken seriously.
Yeah, a horrible detail as well of how the public were so under the pretense that it would just be sex workers that were targeted. The father of Jane McDonald, the police arrived at their house the following morning. She'd obviously been gone the whole night. The police officer knocks on the door. The dad answers, are you the father of Jane? He says, yes, I'm going to kill her when she gets home. And apparently the police officer then goes, you might not have to.
Oh.
Yeah.
Don't do a bit if you're like police officer.
Yeah, it's not. Now's not the time.
He's thinking this is like I'm in the movies. It's not, just do your job properly.
You might not have to, see.
Yeah.
So this then kind of turns the whole case, the whole region, the whole country. It sends them into bedlam, and now all women fear for their lives.
So in 1977, the track inquiry ended. So there's still 20,000 cars left for them to check.
Oh, you mean it didn't work?
No, but Sutcliffe's car was on the remaining list. Hmm. So they were going in the right way about it, but yeah, they didn't get to his car there. So,
technology would have probably helped that inquiry quite rapidly.
I mean, it's the 1977.
So. I know. Yeah, fair point.
So if they time traveled, then yeah, it would have been brilliant. You could just time travel to now, Google who did it, then go back.
So on the 1st of October 1977, Sutcliffe murdered Jean Jordan, who was a sex worker from Manchester. So he's now moved into a new city to claim his next victim. In a later confession, Sutcliffe said that he had realised how he had used a new £5 note, one of the newly printed £5 notes, as part of the financial exchange with her.
Payment.
As payment, yeah, thank you so much. You know, the following evening, Sutcliffe is at a family party with his in-laws and Sonia, and realises that he could potentially be traced by this new £5 note. So he makes the decision to spend a bit more time at the party and then drop his in-laws off at home. That provides him with a perfect kind of alibi. As far as he's aware, he's been at a party. He then heads over to Manchester to try and recover this £5 note. He searches everywhere and he could not find it. Potentially in rage, he then further mutilates Jordan's corpse.
So one of the interesting bits of evidence from this particular murder was the fact that the police found that there were certain fly eggs, because the body had been there for a little while, and these because the body was left out in the sun. The fly eggs in the body were actually would only be in there if it was in the shade in a cool, damp space. So it showed the body had been laying there for a couple of days in the damp space, but then he moved it.
Yeah.
Which is, it's a very... It's a peculiar thing that he went back there, and obviously a peculiar thing to move it. In a way, it's like he moved it from a hidden area as well into a more, lit area for people to see it.
Another gruesome bit of detail from here is obviously Sutcliffe had gone there for the sole purpose of finding and retrieving this £5 note. So he didn't take his kit with him, his hammer, his screwdriver, his knives. When he did become enraged, he didn't have any weapons on him, but he was furious. So he picked up some broken glass and slashed her stomach more before trying to remove her head with the broken glass, but he was unsuccessful. Yeah. But that's just a bit more of an insight to his psyche there. So another little tidbit, on the 9th of October, Jordan's body was discovered by, at the time, dairy worker, but future actor, Bruce Jones. I did have to Google this, but he's Les from Coronation Street.
There you go.
Some more information on that freshly printed £5 note. So the police start working closely together with operatives from the Bank of England, and together they are able to trace the batch of £5 notes to which it had been delivered to a branch of the Midland Bank in Shipley.
So following on from this information from the bank, the police interviewed people who were working at these places, and that led them to interview Sutcliffe. And that happened on November the 2nd. So by this stage, they'd already interviewed a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And Sutcliffe said, I think there's 400 over that weekend. And he said he could have said anything to them by this point, because they're so tired. Mm-hmm. He was just, able to say, he said a weak excuse basically, and Sonia, his wife, backed him up.
I was at a party.
Yeah, and then they were like, okay, that's fine. They just took it for gospel. I mean, it's one of those where that's from your M's, Ben's Magic M's, or wherever he said it was. They basically said, yes, they made a mistake. They just took his word for it. Didn't really kind of dig into it or and see anything other than that. So by this stage as well, we're saying that he was starting to enjoy the kind of press and the kind of fame around it. And as we said, with Sonia's parents, they're a lot more conservative, didn't have a TV. He actually struck up a relationship with the neighbor, Ronald. He'd go over there and watch TV around there when they're spending time over the in-laws, which I can't imagine that going well, saying, I'm just going to pop over to Ronald's because I want to watch some telly. So he spent time with Ronald a lot of time, go to the pubs with Ronald, and also go to the red light district areas with Ronald. But Ronald said he would just go to sleep in the car when he would go off and speak to other women. But apparently, driving through the red light district, Peter once said, this is Ripper country. Mm. Which, in hindsight, obviously, is a lot more chilling. But I mean, at the time, it was just correct. That's where most of the crimes were being committed. But that's an interesting point there.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, hindsight's a beautiful thing, but a lot of his close friends and people that he would encounter in the pubs would say that a lot of the time he would talk with them about what they thought of the crimes, who they thought it could be, and he would chip in with, his own opinion of it. So he's very involved, as often serial killers are, with, his own case.
And even with the mock-ups, people at his work would jokingly call him the Ripper, because obviously he looked like him.
A week later, they interview him for a second time, but this time they follow it up by following through the alibi that he was at a house party, by catching up with Sutcliffe's mother to corroborate that housewarming party story. So as far as they're concerned, case closed. It can't possibly be Peter William Sutcliffe.
Yes. So the 14th of December 1977, Sutcliffe attacked Marilyn Moore. She was another sex worker from Leeds, but she survived. There are tire tracks in the scene which match the earlier attacks, and the description also matched the one of the attacker.
So we move into 1978, and in January, they call off the £5 note lead. Later that month, Sutcliffe would kill again. This time, 21-year-old sex worker Yvonne Pearson, who was from Bradford. And again, a similar pattern. He repeatedly bludgeoned her about the head with a ball-peen hammer, then jumped on her chest before stuffing horsehair into her mouth from a discarded sofa under which he hid her body near Lum Lane.
10 days later, he went on to kill Helen Ritzker, an 18-year-old sex worker from Huddersfield. Her body was found 3 days later beneath the railway arches. So, it's got a very clear pattern. He's still, even after the interviews, he hasn't been scared. He's still going to carry on, still be as brash.
Not as to be was. Swayed. Yeah. No. Okay, so we move on to the 8th of March, 1978. Now, we've done an Instagram post about this individual that would later be known as having been responsible for this. But the first letter having claimed to be written by the Yorkshire Ripper arrives addressed to Chief Constable George Oldfield. And it reads, Dear Sir, I am sorry I cannot give my name for obvious reasons. I am the Ripper. I've been dubbed a maniac by the press, but not you. You call me clever, and I am. You and your mates haven't got a clue that the photo in the paper gave me fits, and that bit about me killing myself, no chance. I've got things to do. My purpose to rid the streets of them sluts. Warn whores to keep off streets because I feel it coming on again. Sorry about young lassie. Referring to McDonald, he didn't know was not a sex worker. Jack the Ripper. He concludes, might write again later. I'm not sure last one really deserved it. Whores getting younger each time. Old slut next time, I hope. Huddersfield never again. Too small, close call last one.
So this is obviously a huge huge part of the police investigation. They've got a letter from the Ripper the first time that he's reached out to them, or so they think. The letter was postmarked from Sunderland. So they thought the person was local to the area. Well, they rightly thought that. But then this immediately is just thrown the cat amongst the pigeons. They're like, should we bring our investigation over to Sunderland? Is he just posted a letter from there? There's a lot of questions they're asking themselves. Even some of the language used in there, like lassie, it's like, it does imply northern, further north, sorry. But it's really, this is where the police had a kind of crossroad. Do they still keep the search down here, or do they take it up north?
Yeah, the man responsible for this decision, George Oldfield, would cop a lot of the criticism, and he took this case extremely personally. He would never go home. He'd work 24-hour shifts in the office. He had a couple of bottles of whiskey in his drawer, and his health would also rapidly deteriorate during taking on this case. But he received a hell of a lot of stick, and he makes up one of my magic M's, mistakes.
In terms of the just the stress the police were under, one of his tactics was writing everything on palm cards.
Yeah, palm cards.
So and they had to reinforce the floor of the police station because the weight of the cards were, you know, tons and tons and tons. Which you think, just the fact of going through that, like how impractical it is to go through those to find and collate information. But they had reinforced the floor of the police station because there's so much evidence. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously they've interviewed thousands of people, like 5,000 people just about the £5 note, mm-hmm. 20,000, 30,000 people about the car, even just that alone, the manpower alone. Mm-hmm. I'm sure a lot of people weren't seeing their family a lot during that time as the policeman.
Exactly. And again, you can then kind of see how maybe time and time again, Sutcliffe did slip through the cracks, you know, or slip through the paper cards, you know. It's from that side you can see, but then again, the warning signs were there on multiple occasions.
Yes, I mean, the big thing for me is just the photo fit of Sutcliffe and how, you know, the first three were pretty bang on in terms of the descriptions. So on the 16th of May 1978, Sutcliffe killed Vera Millward in an attack in the car park of Manchester Royal Infirmary. So again, it's a very public place. He's getting more and more brash as he goes on. I think after these interviews he's done, and he's got away with it. He's just
feeling invincible,
yeah,
maybe.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so on the 13th of August 1978, Sutcliffe is interviewed for the third time. So he's interviewed after his red Ford Corsair, not to be confused with a Vauxhall Corsa. Two very different cars. The police had noted that the red Ford Corsair had been observed going through Bradford's red light district no fewer than 7 separate occasions.
Yeah, so they started monitoring the red light districts and seeing who were regularly frequenting those places. Mm-hmm. But they also keep an eye on separate ones to see if it's just one person in the same place, they weren't too bothered. But if they're going all to the different ones, yeah, they're keeping a close eye on that.
So an interesting bit of tension had developed here as well between police officers kind of observing and trying to keep the streets safe and the sex workers themselves, because obviously they were out to work, they wanted to work, but there was a very conflictual relationship between the two. The police were obviously, you know, not forcing them, but very, you know, very much encouraging them to go home.
Yeah.
And obviously they had the need to be out there and, you know, and earning money. A lot of them came from poverty at the sure. time. So it was a very, very tumultuous relationship there. But also we've had multiple people mention, in preparation for this case that they had relatives. One person mentioned that their great aunt was a police officer, and she was actually made to go
Undercover.
Undercover, yeah, on the streets. We have multiple people. I don't know if this was just a trend at the time, but multiple people that had bearded and long dark-haired relatives that were interviewed and accused at times for being the Ripper himself. So everyone's panicking at this point. People are living in fear, and they are, you know, no closer to catching him.
So during that time, when he was interviewed about that, he said that was just his route home, and that they kind of, and Sonia backed that up.
He's a trucker, you know, any route could be his route home.
I mean, Sonia offered alibis for her husband's presence on two murders. So, I mean, by this stage as well, she's offering all these alibis, which obviously she knows isn't true. You kind of question in a bit, how much is she starting to go, oh, all these mugshots look awful lot like Peter.
Yeah, looks like our Peter.
Yeah, so very curious.
There you go. Another footnote from that is that while interviewed, the police were unaware that Sutcliffe had recently bought a black Sunbeam rapier, and that had actually also been clocked 9 times in the same red light district.
So on the 4th of April 1979, Sutcliffe killed Josephine Whittaker, a 19-year-old building society clerk whom he attacked on Savile Park Moor in Halifax when she was walking home. So the thing about this one is, she's not a sex worker, and it is, I don't think he's made a mistake here. I think he's now knows the police are monitoring the red light district areas, and his hatred for women is just, he's like, I'm not just going to do sex workers, I'm going to go broaden it, which again will cause more panic in the area and cause more, you know, mayhem.
I mean, they're all innocent victims at the end of the day, but this is again at the time in the public causing more outrage because it's not, you know, a red light district.
So the assistant chief constable George Oldfield would receive a recorded tape from the Ripper, and for people listening, the Ripper in inverted commas, which would lead the investigation in a different way.
I have the greatest respect for you, George, but Lord, you are no nearer catching me now than 4 years ago when I started. I warned you in March that I'd strike again.
So yes, so it's very eerie listening to that.
Yeah, chilling. And if you listen to it under the view that that's the legitimate Ripper, yeah, it's horrifying, and you can understand why potentially Oldfield would redirect the inquiries further north to the kind of Wearside Sunderland area.
So with that they found there was no fingerprints on the tape. He was very careful about that. But there's a single grain of custard powder, meaning that he has likely been put together in his kitchen, which doesn't narrow it down, really. I mean, lots of people have kitchens. But for the first time ever, they managed to extract saliva from the seal of the envelope, and they found out he had one of the rarest blood types in the country, shared by only 6% of the population. Yeah. So that's immediately going to... They think, oh, amazing, that's narrowed this down.
And I mean, any chance they get to kind of chase a lead, they clearly are chasing it, you know, full force. I mean, you can't blame them. But this moment itself, and we'll go on to discuss the person that was behind these letters and tapes, you know, this caused a massive amount of diversion from the actual area of where the investigation should have been. And this is where the mistakes and the mayhem come into play slightly more. So they redirect some inquiries to go to Sunderland. He actually ends up, Oldfield, sending hundreds of officers on what is now known as a wild goose chase from door to door through various towns within Sunderland. So that is going on. During this point, the 6th of August 1979, Oldfield falls ill. So George Oldfield's body finally revolts against the 14-hour, 7-day weeks he is working, and he suffers a series of minor heart attacks. He is forced to go on sick leave.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it just shows how much he was given to the investigation. On the 1st of September 1979, Sutcliffe murdered 20-year-old Barbara Leach, a Bradford University student. Her body was dumped at the rear of 13 Ashgrove under a pile of bricks. It's just the complete lack of respect he has for anyone at this stage. It's just horrible. This was a murder of a woman who was not a sex worker, which again prompted alarm from the public. As I said, he's winded. It doesn't have to be sex workers now. He's winded his net. It can be a victim.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So on the 13th of September 1979, a special notice is issued, and this goes out to the whole... I mean, I was talking to my parents, they remember this news alert going out, you know, and they're at the south of the country. So on the strength of their belief in the validity of the Ripper letters and subsequent tape, West Yorkshire Police issue a nationwide special notice to all police forces stating that a person can be eliminated, remember that word, from the inquiries if, number one, they are not born between 1924 and 1959. Number two, he is an obvious coloured person. Number three, his shoe size is 9 or above. Interesting one there. Number four, his blood group is other than B. And number five, perhaps most importantly, his accent is dissimilar to a northeastern Geordie accent. So basically, if they don't have a Geordie accent and their shoe size is over size 9, you can eliminate them.
Yeah, so obviously that's eliminating, well, Sutcliffe. So
Sutcliffe is, yeah, on hearing this, he must have been the happiest man in the country.
So on the 25th of January 1980, Sutcliffe is arrested for drink driving. You would have thought at this time he would be more careful. And when he was waiting trial for this, he actually went on to kill two more women, which he thinks he, you know, he can get away with anything at this stage. And to be fair, he has. And
continues to do so.
Yes. Yeah, he also went on to attack three other women who survived in Leeds on 24th of September.
So on the 17th of November 1980, this is late at night, Sutcliffe, having eaten some chicken and chips from KFC, he spots Jacqueline Hill and follows her to a quiet dark spot where he attacks her with his hammer before stabbing her many times with a sharpened screwdriver. Apparently, and this is grim by the way, still disturbed by the fact that her eyes were still open looking at him, he viciously stabs her through one of her eyes. 20-year-old Jacqueline Hill was a student at Leeds University. Her body was found on wasteland near the Arndale Centre. So the 25th of November 1980, Trevor Birdsall, a friend of Peter Sutcliffe who had been with him on the night of his first attack, finally makes his suspicions formal, writing to the police, "I have good reason to know the man you are looking for in the Ripper case. This man has dealings with prostitutes and always had a thing about them. His name and address is Peter Sutcliffe, 6 Garden Lane, Heaton, Bradford. Works for Clark's Transport Shipley." Despite being marked as priority number one and indexed against Sutcliffe's name, it is lost in the filing system until after his eventual arrest.
Yeah, that's one of those where you go, yeah, that is just completely on them. A huge mistake there. The fact is a friend as well saying it. Yeah. Even earlier on, one of the cases where one of the girls earlier on who survived the hammer attack, she was really trying to stress to the police, his accent isn't from, he's not a Geordie. Yeah. He's local to this area, but they wouldn't listen.
And going back to Marcella as well, the lady that he picked up from the party, the drunk lady, she was discounted again because of her ethnicity, and she provided a perfect summary of his description. And again, this is super early on. You know, I think he'd only had maybe 3 or 4 victims before that.
So during the investigation, the pressure on the police was piling on, and they brought some code breakers in from Bletchley Park, just kind of trying to figure out if there's a pattern somewhere or how, you know, why the murder's been committed, where they are. Mm-hmm. And basically what they used was a system they used, a formula they used to locate airfields on mainland Europe by the timings of when the murders would happen. Mm-hmm. And the kind of route in which they'd go. They really went kind of forensic on it and figuring out mathematically how and what, like where he would be based. And they did say he'd be based in the Bradford area.
That's it.
Which is amazing they could figure that out. It's very calculated.
They basically mapped out where his victims were, where they occurred, and kind of flagged them on a map. And then you could kind of see the central radius was Bradford.
In terms of if he was going to, for example, if he used the murders in Bradford were committed earlier in the day, whereas if it's in Leeds, it'd be slightly later, and he'd be able to drive from there to there. They've basically mapped it out and figured out Bradford is the place we need to be looking. And yeah, that's what.
And on the flip side, I guess Sutcliffe always had up his sleeve the fact that he was a HGV driver. Yep. He was going through various, red light districts, but that was part of his commute, if you will.
Definitely.
So he had an answer for everything. So on the 5th of January 1981, Sutcliffe is formally charged with murder at Dewsbury Police Station. Now, this is the archival footage that always you can hear and feel evil in the air when they pull him in. And you can hear bastard, you can hear die, ripper, die, all sorts you can hear.
People thinking of neighbours were the killer, all these things, all culminates in the anger that's shown to him. So when Sutcliffe was arrested, the police got him into the interview. They asked him to undress in front of him. And This is one of the most bizarre things. He pulled down his trousers and he revealed that he's wearing a V-neck sweater, but on his legs.
Yes.
So his penis was always ready to kind of, you know, essentially a rape outfit. That's what he was wearing it for. And also the kind of patches on the elbows to protect his knees. Can you imagine he's gone from this position of thinking that he's immortal, he's not going to get caught, to now standing in front of policemen wearing a V-neck sweater around his legs with a knob out.
So obviously the monologue at the beginning of the episode, you know, talked about the night he was caught and he was then held for 2 days before he eventually confessed. And it's quite a, goosebumps kind of moment when he finally admits it. So it was Detective Boyle who was interviewing Sutcliffe, and he asks, do you recall that before you were put into a police car at Sheffield that you had left your car and went to the side of a house? Sutcliffe responds, yes, I went to urinate against the wall. Boyle, I think you went for another purpose. No response from Sutcliffe. Boyle then goes on to say, do you understand what I'm saying? I think you are in some serious trouble. Sutcliffe, I think you have been leading up to it. Boyle, leading up to what? Sutcliffe, the Yorkshire Ripper. Boyle, what about the Yorkshire Ripper? Sutcliffe, well, it's me.
So yeah, Sutcliffe went, pretended he was going to go urinate, but he actually dropped off some of his, a rope, wasn't it? A rope and a hammer?
Rope, hammer, and I believe a small knife.
Yeah.
His little murder kit. To go off that as well, shortly after he confessed, the first person he wanted to speak to. I mean, the confession is online. It is well worth a read if you get the time. But he wanted to speak to Sonia before anyone else. And Sonia then, upon hearing this, I mean, she's in complete shock. She kind of demands that before he's taken away, he comes to the house and eats cake and has a glass of milk, which he does. And the police allow him to do, handcuffed to another one of the constables.
That's very bizarre. So 19th of May, 1981, he's found guilty of 13 charges of murder and 7 of attempted murder. He is sentenced to 30 years, with the judge remarking he believes Sutcliffe to be beyond redemption. So on the 22nd of May, 1981, he begins his sentence at Parkhurst.
Yeah, so there was obviously a lot of national attention on this, but also, you know, other prisoners, other convicts were aware that he'd been, you know, killing girls and women. So there was anger from every direction on Sutcliffe. Now,
yeah, and very young women as well, which, you know, anyone killing or any harm towards kids in prison is seen as, you know, the lowest of the low.
Absolutely, absolutely. So on the 10th of January, 1983, Sutcliffe is attacked for the first time in prison. And this is by inmate James Costello, who slashes Sutcliffe's face with a broken coffee jar.
In March 1984, he is sent to Broadmoor under the terms of the 1983 Mental Health Act.
So on the 24th of May, 1989, Sonia Sutcliffe wins damages for a libel from Private Eye. So a jury awards Sonia a record of £600,000 in damages after finding that Private Eye, who were a
political satire magazine,
had attempted to profit from her story. The amount is reduced on appeal to £60,000. So that's a massive reduction.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing with this as well. Like, Sonia, she doesn't seem to be punished for the fact that she's given alibis. I know, obviously, she's in a situation with a killer, a serial killer, but she's provided alibis for her husband all the way through this. And she's obviously Private Eye, who are known for being very kind of sarcastic and making jokes about things. £60,000, she's won there. In April 1994, Sonia finally divorces Sutcliffe. So he's been in prison now for over 10 years. And she finally decides enough is enough.
23rd of February 1996, Sutcliffe is again attacked in prison, this time by fellow prisoner and convicted robber Paul Wilson, who attempted to strangle Sutcliffe in his cell with a pair of earphones.
It'll do the job.
That adds up.
So the 10th of March 1997, he is attacked again in prison by fellow prisoner Ian Kay, and he blinds Sutcliffe in the left eye with a pen. And badly damages the right.
So the 17th of September 2003, the police announced that they are calling off the search for the Ripper hoaxer. So obviously, having arrested Sutcliffe, they're aware that it's not a Geordie accent or even a Wearside accent, and that it's quite a thick Yorkshire accent that they are dealing with. There is, you know, public outrage at the time of, well, who was this hoaxer? And look at the amount of damage they've done and the distraction they have caused from the real case. But the police claim that the offender cannot now be prosecuted for the charge of wasting police time because of the time that has now expired. We have no plans to continue with the matter.
On the 20th of October 2005, an arrest for being drunk and disorderly had led to John Humble's DNA being placed on the National Police database. And the DNA matched the saliva on the seal of the letter. So they linked that there, and they arrested him on perverting the course of justice.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, maybe Humble had plans on taking that to the grave with him. It's not something I can imagine he would freely admit.
It was time for him to eat some humble pie, maybe with that custard that he liked so much.
That's good squishy. Humble at the time was an unemployed alcoholic and longtime resident of Sunderland.
When he was arrested, it was public knowledge of the fact that he was the one, he was Wearside Jack. Peter Sutcliffe did write some letters to him and kind of addressed it. He said, "You could have saved those three women, John. You have blood on your hands," which is quite, you know, It obviously he did. I mean, he But he said, you could even end up in Broadmoor with me. That is where you belong. So, and then after a while, he kind of got a bit warmer. Said, be strong. God will look after you. Your friend Peter is how we ended the letter. So yeah, it was a very disruptive thing, and it would have cost, you know, thousands upon thousands of pounds on the whole investigation, his red hair in there.
Mm-hmm. So the 1st of June 2006, the Byford Report is published, and this is the secret report of Sir Lawrence Byford into the investigation and failures of the police forces and their efforts to apprehend the Yorkshire Ripper. So they obviously had multiple kind of regional police forces on the case. They also pulled up some individuals from Scotland Yard at the point when they thought, you know, that the local Yorkshire police were failing, which was quite interesting because there were kind of some smimy comments from Yorkshire saying that they still haven't caught Jack the Ripper. So yeah. Why would they catch the Yorkshire Ripper? So the Byford Report is published, and it's fully published. It's available if you want to check it out. It's a massive amount of information, but it comes in to conclude that there were a huge number of errors, multiple level errors, but a lot, unfortunately, came from George Oldfield.
So on the 16th of July 2010, Sutcliffe is given the full life term. So now he's no longer to apply for parole. He's no longer able to, you know, try and leave. He's now going to be there until the day he dies. You know, it's always curious, what's the reason behind these things? We've already speculated some motives and things going on. Part of it, when he was younger, apparently he was very fascinated about the human body and all these kind of things. A very weird one was he was reportedly really obsessed with STDs. Which is a very strange thing for a kid to be obsessed with. But he'd go to a local wax museum, which had a whole exhibition about the kind of how the body reacts to certain things, which is a very bizarre thing, a passion to have as a kid, STDs.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. Another is that he was trying to reconcile the loving mother he had idolized. And that is basically that his father had portrayed his mother as being a very, you know, well, the words I've got here are sluttish woman, and obviously the affairs. So he wanted to reconcile that and clear the streets by saying that each woman was either a pure virgin mother worthy of sacred love, or they were a sinful whore.
So we like to look at how these kind of cases are reflected into popular culture as well. There was Brass Eye, a great show, a very satirical show. They actually made a Peter Sutcliffe the musical.
On day release from Broadmoor Prison, Sutcliffe has been rehearsing intensively for 3 months.
And I really am so very truly sorry.
I think it was the third or fourth murder where a newspaper referred to him as a ripper. Obviously, the comparisons have been there for Jack the Ripper throughout with the hoax letters, the hoax audio. But if you put them side by side, Jack the Ripper had 5 victims, whereas the Yorkshire Ripper had 22 victims, 13 of which were murdered and 9 were seriously injured.
Yeah, so it's an awful lot. Like, he managed to cause such mayhem there.
One of the M's.
Well, there you go. Maybe your M's aren't so muggish. One thing Ben mentioned earlier on was our Instagram. I was posting about it. There's a quite a famous picture of ex-fighter Frank Bruno shaking hands with Peter Sutcliffe. And this, Frank Bruno said, Savile planned it. It was not a nice thing to do to me. If I had known it was the Ripper, I'd have tried to get out of it. It was a scary feeling. I'd rather shake hands with Mike Tyson.
Another weird bit of information is that during his time as a trucker, you know, with his HGV license, he had a handwritten note while he slept in his truck, and that was displayed on the front window. And it said, in this truck is a man whose latent genius, if unleashed, would rock the nation, whose dynamic energy would overpower those around him. Better let him sleep. And that was handwritten by Sutcliffe.
I think that very much sums him up as a person.
Yeah.
I think that's quite a nice bit to end it on, Ben.
Yeah.
And that was the case of Peter Sutcliffe, the Yorkshire Ripper.
A big case. I mean, we haven't seen the edit yet. Obviously, we're right here, but I imagine this is going to be one of our longest episodes yet.
Yes, but what a way to kick off series 2.
We're back, baby.
Thank you very much for watching. And if you enjoyed the case, please give us a like, give us a comment. Let us know if there's any cases you want to see in the future. We are doing mini cases on Patreon if we do think the case doesn't quite warrant a full episode.
Yeah, there's a few up there already, actually.
There's already a handful up there. So please come along and have a chat and let us know what you think.
Yeah, and thank you guys again for your continued support. Obviously, we've had a little break now, but we've got weekly episodes back. We are, we're in Boston Sound with Dan the Man. Say something, Dan.
Yeah, we're really excited to be back. We've got some great cases coming up. And we recently hit 20,000 audio downloads, which is amazing.
Unbelievable.
Yes, we can't wait to show you what's coming up.
Yeah, there's some biggies coming. Keep telling your friends about us. Tell your family about us. Share us. And if you could leave a like or a rating, we would really appreciate it because that seriously helps us grow. Get us back up those charts.
Yep. Okay, guys. Until next time.
Bye.
Bye.